Anyone who's ever sung in an organized group setting, like a choir, has probably had a musical director talk to them about blending or ensemble, maybe by commenting on how the singers are doing different mouth shapes while singing. Ensemble is a somewhat vague concept. It all comes down to how well the singers succeed in creating the illusion of a single, unified voice. But how exactly is this illusion achieved? And, more importantly, what can we change about the way a line is sung when this illusion isn't achieved? The word ensemble means together, and in a musical context, it can have different meanings, as it's a general word for describing a group of musicians performing together, but can also refer to how well the musicians perform together. In choral and a cappella music, ensemble is usually used to describe how well the different members of a voice part are doing at creating a unified sound, where nobody's voice can be heard separately from the rest. If someone's voice is sticking out, for any reason, you'd say that ensemble is broken, or that the blend isn't right. There are a few different factors that can lead to broken ensemble. For example, if someone's singing flat, this tends to break ensemble. However, you can have situations where everyone's in tune and yet the blend isn't right. What might add to this problem is that not all singers and musical directors know what to do in order to achieve ensemble, leading to comments like, "You need to blend more," or even just, "Something's not right, try again," which don't really help much. So in order to look at what makes voices blend, I asked some of my experienced choral singing friends to sing together in groups of differing sizes with the instructions, "Try to blend together," and "Sing as a soloist without worrying too much about blend," to see how the sound would change and what the singer's natural instincts would be in each case. Before we get into that, let's look at what I was taught while studying orchestration and what I've been told when singing in choirs over the years. First of all, the tuning has to be together in order to achieve ensemble. Secondly, the singers need to use the same mouth shapes if they want to blend. Third, if the blend isn't right, the singers should smile, which will probably fix it. While these are good pointers for achieving blend, they don't really tell us much about how they fix the blend, just that they do. So, if all you wanted to know was how to fix problematic ensemble in your group, these should get you there. However, if you're interested in knowing exactly why a sound blends, this is what we're going to get into now. Just to be scientific about this, I've recorded all the groups with the same microphone setting and position. I used a Zoom H2 recorder, which is an extremely useful recording device that records stereo sound set to medium gain. I'd show it to you, but I'm using it to record myself right now, so I'm just going to put a picture of it, like, here. I've used it a lot over the last 7 years. In fact, all the background music on the show was recorded on it. Next, I put the recordings into Logic Pro and did a high-pass filter to remove any frequencies below the lowest frequencies that the singers would use, plus I added some slight compression to make the sound more even in terms of volume. In order to analyze the sound that the singers created, I used software that creates a spectrogram of the recording. Spectrograms show the frequencies that a sound consists of graphically, and they look a bit like infrared pictures, in that the loudest frequencies are shown in a bright red or yellow color, with the quieter ones being green or blue. The software I used is called Sing and See, and it also tracks pitching, so it's a really useful tool for singers when they're practicing. If you want to learn more about spectrograms, check out the video I've linked on the screen. The singers I used for the recordings are a combination of female altos and sopranos. I kept them the same sex to avoid using singers with significantly different larynx positions. That being said, the singers have very different individual voices, with pop, folk, soul, and classically leaning singers represented. So we'll get a chance to hear singers that may not obviously sound the same performing as a unit. The song I picked for them to perform is the English folk song Scarborough Fair, and I put it in B minor so that it covers A3 to B4. arrange both altos and sopranos should be fairly comfortable singing in. So, let's meet our first singer, Therese. Therese is a singer, writer, and performance maker working across a range of genres and expressions. Her 2019 projects include singing poetry by women writers set to music by yours truly, and developing a musical, glittery, and ketchupy piece of norm-critical and feminist theatre. The song she's singing is from her theatre piece Mission Abort, and it's a really good choice for demonstrating how the spectrogram works, as it uses a small range of pitches, but a very wide dynamic range. Notice that when she's singing quietly, there are few strong overtones, whereas when she gets loud, there are more and much stronger overtones shown. Also, notice the area between these two yellow lines. The lower one is at 2 kHz and the higher at 4 kHz. This is a frequency range where the human ear is especially sensitive, and singers will strengthen overtones in this range to be heard clearly over other instruments. This is why it's also referred to as the singer's formant, a formant being another term for a strong overtone. Now, let's hear Therese singing Scarborough Fair on her own before we start introducing other singers.
Are you going to Scarborough Fair? Parsley, sage, rosemary and thyme. Remember me to one who lives there. He once was a true love of mine.
Let's add in another singer, Helga.
Every time we say goodbye, I die a little.
Helga is a classically trained singer and composer, and she mostly performs in contemporary folk, theatre, and metal productions.
Why the gods above me who must be in the know?
She's also an actor and frequently works as an actor musician in the UK and Iceland.
They allow you to go.
Now, let's put Therese and Helga together and hear how they perform Scarborough Fair when trying to blend.
Are you going to Scarborough Fair? Parsley, sage, rosemary and thyme. Remember me to one who lives there. He once was a true love of mine.
Notice that there aren't any particularly strong overtones in this performance. The distribution seems to be pretty even. Now, compare this with a recording where they sing more like soloists, not worrying too much about blending.
Are you going to Scarborough Fair? Parsley, sage, rosemary and thyme. Remember me to one who lives there. He once was a true love of mine.
So, the most obvious observation is probably that the soloistic approach is much louder than the blending one, and it has more strong overtones. I think that skilled singers tend to sing a bit quieter when trying to blend, as they're focusing not only on singing, but also on listening and matching their surroundings. This is also why I think it's bad practice if singers stuff their ears while singing in groups, as it takes away much of the information needed to blend with their surroundings. This is also a good time to mention something else that orchestrators get taught, which is that it's notoriously difficult for two instruments with similar timbre performing together to achieve a perfect blend, as there's likely to be very slight tuning differences between them, regardless of the skill of the musicians. I think we observe this phenomenon with Therese and Helga here, as though the blend is quite good in both recordings due to them singing with similar timbre, the blend is definitely broken at certain points due to very slight tuning differences. This is why I recommend avoiding two singers to a part if you can, and rather use three or more. This might not always be possible, of course, but just be aware of the additional difficulty involved for singers trying to blend when singing two to a part. Let's add another singer to the mix. This is Heps.
Fly me to the moon and let me sing among the stars.
Heps is a singer-songwriter from London. She's from a contemporary music background and mostly performs in jazz and popular music genres.
In other words, hold my hand.
She has 12 years' experience as a vocal coach and piano teacher.
Darling, kiss me.
Let's put Heps with Therese and Helga and see how they sound when trying to blend together.
Are you going to Scarborough Fair? Parsley, sage, rosemary and thyme. Remember me to one who lives there. He once was a true love of mine.
This is a pretty good blend, in my opinion, though it does highlight another factor that can lead to broken ensemble: vowel shapes. You can hear on the longer vowels, such as fair at the end of the first phrase and time at the end of the second, that the voices don't seem to blend together perfectly. There may be some slight tuning differences as well, but if the different singers are singing with different vowel shapes, they'll be emphasizing different overtones, which makes them sound like separate instruments. If you remember the episode that I did on the harmonic series, you'll remember that every resonance sound consists of various different frequencies, and that the relative strength of each of these will affect the overall sound. For example, let's take the sound R from time. If using the sort of R sound that is common in southern England, it might be rendered like this. Notice that the first through fifth partials are strong here, with two additional peaks at the 10th and 14th partials. If going for a more northern or American sounding ah, it might sound like this. When compared with the other vowel, there's an additional strong sixth partial here and notably more distortion in the sound, maybe due to some added twang, which I'll talk about in a minute. Neither of these is necessarily better than the other, but if half of your singers do one and the other half the other, they'll be emphasizing different overtones. Another important factor is whether or not there is twang or nasality in the sound. In contemporary pop and musical theatre music, twang is very important and commonly heard, whereas classical singers tend to avoid using it. Again, neither is better than the other, but they will sound notably different, so you'll want to decide on which to go with if you find that singers break ensemble due to vowel shapes and amount of twang. Speaking of twang, let's have a listen to Therese, Helga and Heps singing together as soloists.
Are you going to Scarborough Fair? Parsley, sage, rosemary and thyme. Remember me to one who lives there. He once was a true love of mine.
I love how we're getting more action in the faces once they start approaching the song like soloists. Notice how Therese and Heps both perform with notable twang, making the overall sound much louder, whereas Helga doesn't use twang, and so she ends up getting a bit covered over by the others. However, I wouldn't say that the use of twang is necessarily what breaks the ensemble in this case, as some of them now start putting their own spin on the song by adding extra notes and effects. This is great for solo singing, but it does break ensemble when singing in a group, so it's important to spend time getting those extra notes together if you're looking for blend. Another factor that can affect the blend is the use of vibrato. Full disclosure, I love vibrato and I think it's a great feature of singing. If you don't know, vibrato is a regular and rapid oscillation of pitch in a sound that you commonly hear with a lot of instruments, singers and strings being obvious examples. However, it's a factor that can affect ensemble, and it's a contentious point for some musicians. I think it's worth spending more time on vibrato, so I'll look into it in more detail in the next episode. For now, let's just remark that it can make a voice sound separate from the others in a group, especially in such a small group. But let's get back to our singers and introduce a new one. Caitlin.
Swing low, sweet chariot.
Caitlin is a session singer who studied at London College of Creative Media, and she also has a Bachelor in Music from the Royal Conservatoire of Scotland as an oboist. She currently sings with the band Sans Souci and has performed as a backing singer with Tom Chaplin. We've already established that blending two voices is very difficult, so let's make a group of three using Caitlin, Helga, and Heps, and hear what they sound like when aiming for a blended sound.
Are you going to Scarborough Fair? Parsley, sage, rosemary, and thyme. Remember me to one who lives there. He once was a true love of mine.
This is a pretty good blend overall, though there are some differing vowel shapes and different amounts of twang that do break ensemble sometimes. I noticed that the higher notes tend to be the most blended. This might be because the top note is located in the break, and these singers negotiate the break using a similar sound, so the blend up there is good. Let's compare with a soloistic approach.
Are you going to Scarborough Fair? Parsley, sage, rosemary, and thyme. Remember me to one who lives there. He once was a true love of mine.
There's a lot more character in this performance, and a lot more volume and strong overtones, but the voices are quite separate due to interpretation, twang, and timing. Notice that there's still pretty strong ensemble on the high notes, again, probably because these singers choose to sing in this part of their range with similar approaches. Let's add Therese to the mix and see if anything changes when there's four singers all trying to blend.
Are you going to Scarborough Fair? Parsley, sage, rosemary, and thyme. Remember me to one who lives there. He once was true love of mine.
Now we're getting very close to a perfect blend. There's a few places where the ensemble is broken slightly due to tuning differences, but it's pretty convincing. However, there are two more factors that can affect the blend which we haven't discussed, and it's worth looking at them now with this good reference recording. These are the placement of the singers and reverb. both of which are factors dependent on the space or room where the singers are performing. Due to the way the recording was made, you're hearing the singers as though you were sitting here and they were placed like this. However, in most performance situations, you'll be listening from farther away, the singers will probably be standing closer together, like this, and the room will colour the sound they create through natural reverberation, or reverb. Reverb is the result of sound bouncing off surfaces and reaching your ears with different amounts of delay, and it tends to make a sound richer by amplifying prominent frequencies and stretching the sound out. You can learn more about it by watching the video I've linked. I can make some adjustments to the recording in Logic to emulate these factors, so we can listen to the singers as though they're on stage in a concert hall, like this. Notice how the reverb smooths over some of the blend issues we heard when we were listening to the earlier version, and that putting the voices closer together in the stereoscopic field makes individual voices stick out less. Concert spaces are designed to maximize this effect, making even solitary voices able to fill the room with sound. So keep in mind that a good concert space can even out any small ensemble issues your group may have. Anyway, let's introduce our final singer, Ruth.
On Raglan Road of an autumn day, I saw her first and knew.
Ruth is a classically trained singer-songwriter who performs in a wide range of settings.
A snare that I might one day rue.
Some of her current projects include working with the electronic drone choir Nix, and singing regularly with a traditional Irish folk band.
And I said, let grief be a fallen leaf at the dawning of the day.
Let's make a group of three with Caitlin, Heps, and Ruth, and hear what they sound like when trying to blend.
Are you going to Scarborough Fair? Parsley, sage, rosemary and thyme. Remember me to one who lives there. He once was a true love of mine.
While there are points where ensemble is broken due to tuning differences, the vowel shapes are very similar for all singers, so the long notes sound notably more blended than in some earlier groups. Let's see what happens when I ask them to perform like soloists together.
Are you going to Scarborough Fair?
As expected, the volume is overall much louder, and there are more strong overtones and twang used in the voices. But I'd say that the main factors that break ensemble here are the timing, added notes, and vibrato. I'm curious to see whether vibrato will matter as much as the group gets larger. Let's add Therese and Helga to the group and see what happens when they all try to blend.
Are you going to Scarborough Fair? Parsley, sage, rosemary and thyme. true love of mine.
What strikes me about this recording is that while you can sometimes pick out individual qualities amongst the voices, they generally seem to get coloured over by the most prominent overtones. For instance, the differences in vibrato and vowel shapes are much less noticeable here than in the smaller groups. Let's try to add some reverb and put the singers closer together and farther away to hear what happens to the ensemble.
Are you going to Scarborough Fair? Parsley, sage, rosemary and thyme. Remember me to one who lives there.
Now, if I went to a concert and listened to singers performing the song like this, I'd definitely buy it. It's not completely devoid of individual qualities, but there is more or less consistent ensemble throughout. However, there still needs to be an intent to blend, as we can hear if comparing with a version where the singers all perform like soloists.
Are you going to Scarborough Fair?
Yeah, this is great in many ways, but ensemble is not one of them. So, to summarize, in order to achieve convincing ensemble, the singers and musical director have to keep the following things in mind. 1. The tuning and timing have to be together. 2. The vowel shapes, and by extension the overtones, need to match. And 3. Vibrato needs to be used with care, at least in small groups. Before we finish, I wanted to see whether four blending singers could mask the effect of someone singing flat and not really knowing what was going on. So I asked Therese to deliberately sing badly, and, well, the first attempt to record it turned out like this.
Are you going to Scarborough Fair?
And I was really good.
It was really good. Sorry, I find this kind of stuff so funny.
You've got the easiest job here.
No, but I find this kind of stuff so funny. After I put the camera on a tripod and composed myself, we got the following result. And, well, it kind of speaks for itself.
Are you going to Scarborough Fair?
So, no. Four blending singers can't mask a bad one, unfortunately. And you really do need to make sure all the singers are putting in their best effort. Okay, that's quite enough for one episode. I hope you enjoyed it and that you learned something. As usual, leave me a comment if you have any questions and share this video with your friends if you think they'll find it useful. And I'll see you in the next episode.
Love.